which tell these things, but there are not very many. It depends on also on what language you you read. I have asked, I have searched for English translations of old Arabic texts. There is essentially one text by Harizmi which was translated. I did not have the translation, but this morning I sent an email to my team member, our team member, Puyan in Iran, Puyan Rezvani, and after 5 minutes I had the PDF, so it was very efficient. So I have that now, but that's for scholars. I mean, it's not very interesting. Biruni has one book which is called Kitab Tafhim Fi Awa'il Sina'at al-Tanji. I have it, is on my USB stick, and there is an English translation. It has a short section on the Asturic, but also with some applications. So this is what you can look at, but it's not enough. And also, some of the applications don't make sense because they are involved with astrology. Astrology was very important at that time. So they always want to know which point of the ecliptic rises at the eastern horizon, because they believed in that for astrological applications. If you are not interested in that, then you don't have to do that, of course. So, but in any case, there is one other article by a certain Morley, which was published in 1856. Also, I hope don't have a PDF, and the article itself is very big, but I will try to produce a scan, and then later I will send it to you. And I will ask Mr. Puyan to translate Biruni's great work on it. He has a work on it on 50 pages with all sorts of applications of the astrolabe. He has it in Arabic already, and he will translate it into English, but only after his PhD. His PhD is on the Arabic edition, but I cannot ask him to translate it into English now, because then the project is too large for a PhD. So, because he is already translating all the text. So, if you can read Persian, there is a text, Bistabda Osturlar by Nasir al-Din Tusi, which you might be able to use. So, this is somewhat difficult, but in any case you have to, you can find your information, and we can always be at your assistance. We have many relationships in Turkey and Iran. If a text is available only in manuscript, we can try to get it from those countries. Hussein has excellent relationships to the Turkish authorities. The Turks only give texts to Turks, to Turkish people, with watermark. But Hussein is Turkish, so that's not a problem, so he can get it for us. And then he can also arrange to have it without watermark. But, anyways. So this is the literature. Anything you have to add to that? To know what literature exists, there is bibliographic work on all the listing all the Islamic astronomers, I think more than 1,000 astronomers, with all the information that is available on them and all the articles that were written about them. That is also on the USB stick. It's by Rosenfeld and Ihsanoglu. It's not completely reliable, but it has a lot of useful information. Okay, so next remark, if you want to make an astrolabe workshop, you always have...
I just have a question on whatever you've already said. Yeah. When you say applications,
yeah,
do you mean the information that you want to extract from an astrolabe?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because you want to use it to solve certain problems.
Right.
For example, how to find the length of daylight, how to find the time, how to find the beginning of Asr prayer today.
Okay.
How to find the beginning of how to find Fajr prayer? How long is Fajr prayer before sunrise? I mean, this can all be done by the astronomy, very easy.
Okay.
And in addition to that, you learn about astronomy also.
Yeah.
Because
so,
it's still valid.
Yeah. So you said about how many applications on the average can you extract from a?
This is a very difficult question. I mean, it depends on the author. Biruni has maybe 40 or 50 applications. I think that's it. A certain Abdurrahman Sufi wrote a book on more than 1,000 applications. But that's sort of phony. In case you want to have it, we also have the manuscript of it.
Okay. And every astrolabe, when it is designed for some purpose.
So I think it's, no, I think it's standard. It's for all these purposes. It's not with one particular purpose in mind. I think pretty much the astrolabe has maybe 40 purposes that you can do with each astrolabe, and then maybe if you want something very special, you want something very easy, you engrave some special lines, for example, the sigmoid curve. In,
that then you do on the back of the astrolabe.
Yeah, you do on the back of the astrolabe.
Yeah. But as far as the astrolabe is concerned, that's always a standard astrolabe.
Yeah, that's what I would suggest. I mean, you can, of course, make workshops on the other astrolabes. The Zorapi astrolabe is also nice. Mr. Wilfred has a workshop on that. Perhaps you can show it.
So you design an astrolabe for a specific latitude?
Yeah. No. The star map is valid for every latitude.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
But then always the model we usually print only one plate, because if you have more plates, then it's too difficult to do that.
Let's say in Pakistan.
Yeah.
I want to make an astrolabe which is good for Karachi, for Lahore, for Peshawar.
Yeah. What's the latitude of Karachi?
It's about 24.
24. Yeah. So what would you say? For how many...
Don't you have presentations for Karachi that are exclusively for Karachi? Because then
I think for Karachi, Mr. Wilfred made the Lahore astrolabe to emphasize the point that Lahore is really the center of this. Too bad for Karachi.
Yeah. They will not like it.
Too good for Lahore.
Yes.
they will not like it.
But you could have done it, because you have it for Mecca and Medina and everything, right?
But Mecca is not 24, I think.
No, Mecca is in the tropics. Mecca is in the tropics.
Yeah.
Medina is out of the tropics. Medina and Karachi should have the same latitude, I guess. So.
Yeah. We didn't do it this time. Also, but you don't know exactly how many models you need in Lahore and how many models you need in Karachi.
Yeah.
But Wilfred can do it.
Okay. So coming back to the original question, let's say I want to make an astrolabe which is good for Pakistan, for the three cities in Pakistan, well, at the extremes, Karachi, Lahore and then Peshawar.
Yes.
It will be three plates.
Yeah, I guess for every 3 degrees it's enough.
For plus minus 3 degrees the same plate can hold you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It depends on how much energy you want to put in.
So one plate for Karachi and one for Islamabad, which will hold good for Lahore and for Peshawar also.
Well, then it will be for Lahore, it will be good for Islamabad and Peshawar also.
Yeah. So and a Pakistani astrolabe, which has got two plates then?
I wouldn't do it with plates, because plates depends. It depends on how much money you want to spend. The models that we use are very cheap. What is the cost approximately? We don't ask you to pay. I mean, that's not why we are.
Yeah, just around 50 euros, cents, I think.
How many models for 50 euros?
Just one model for 50 euro cents.
You
so two models for 1 euro.
So 65 rupees for one model. I mean, this is what we pay.
It's just the paper, the plastic and the button.
No, what I'm saying is, let's say, in Karachi, I get hold of a shop.
Yeah.
And he's good in metal works.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
He's good in metal works, you know. So, and I tell him to make an astrolabe with two plates.
Yeah.
One for 24 degrees, which is for Karachi, and another for 32, which is good for Karachi, Lahore and Islamabad.
Yeah. Yeah.
For Lahore, Islamabad and Peshawar.
Well, what I would do is then, you have not only the place, but also the mata, which is called the model. This is the place where the geographical coordinates were thing. You can also put the plate in there.
Yeah. Okay.
So you have some design there for Lahore. You have the mata because it's the mother of everything, and then you have one plate with one side Karachi and the other side some other city in Pakistan.
Okay. And now this astrolabe will be a standard astrolabe.
Yeah, that's what I would suggest.
Yeah, except for the plates, everything else will be standard, which could be, let's say, the same. It will hold good for, let's say, for London, for maybe.
For London, you would need a new plate, of course, for latitude.
Yeah, but the meter and everything will be
standard. Yeah, the star map will be exactly the same because you have to do the star map only once.
Yeah. Okay. And now. I can extract as many as 40 applications that you say from the same astrolabe.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I can mention some. The Zohar prayer, the Asr prayer, not so much the Maghrib, but the length of daylight, to find the time from the altitude of the sun, to find the altitude of the sun at from the time, and then also at night, finding the time from the altitude of a star. Finding out when a particular star will rise, at what moment, when the star will set, when the sun will rise, when the sun will set, etc., etc. Also the direction, where the star will set, where the sun will set, where it will rise, and so on.
Well, this is the easy part.
Yeah.
The difficult part now, planets.
You can't do it.
Can't do it.
No. You can have, for the sun, you can have a scale on the back side of the astrolabe, as the astrolabe of Mukim, which I showed you.
Yeah.
But the planets cannot be done.
No.
It was never done that way, because the motion of the plants is irregular. And you have, you can have another instrument for that. That's not the estimate, it's something completely different.
Sir, if I understand this correctly, for Pakistan, these two zones of Pakistan, Karachi and Lahore, we would need to plate, but only one spider.
Yeah, spider is the same for
everyone. Right. Right.
Your spider could also be used for the Netherlands.
Same question, different approach. Instead of having two plates, can that plate be switched back?
Yeah. So I would have three plates. I would have one, not a plate, but the matter. I would make the drawing for Lahore, and then one plate, which has a drawing for Karachi, and then, for example, you take the latitude in the middle, and you also have that.
Okay, now...
24, 28, 32, for example.
Now, an astrolabe is not universal. If I go to the southern hemisphere...
then you would have a southern star map.
Then the reti will change.
The spider would be different. Now you need a different projection. Now you... because we take the... projection so you can see the north pole, but then you can see the south. So you should change it.
So then the Tropic of Capricorn will be smaller.
Exactly.
And Tropic of Cancer will be
exactly. Yeah. This is all explained by Farhani in his work, because he also dealt with southern projections.
Okay.
So you can read it there.
Yeah.
Okay. Shall I continue?
Yeah.
So it's very important to. Find the model of your astrolabe. You want to find a model that you want to imitate in your astrolabe. So we chose the Khojandi astrolabe, but you, of course, you want to select the Lahore astrolabe, which you try to emulate somehow in your model. I think this is important in order to sort of bind it with the tradition. And so for that...
There is as well as the art of the artistic touch to the astrolabe.
It's up to you, but I just want to suggest it to you, because I don't want to take you copy of an astrolabe that's now on the internet, because it's all European. So then you have something which is not related to your tradition at all.
We can put some modern things in it. For example, you can put an insignia of elope and gas and.
Of course, you can do that. Well, especially on the backside, could be this.
Yeah. That'll be a modern astrolabe. Huh?
Yeah. you can say created as inspired by Zia and Dean, whatever.
Yeah.
But before we continue, based on what we have been discussing for the past 2 days, my personal project on the side, and what Shahal just said, creating an astrolabe in this point in time, because we have all the modern technologies and satellites, we can get all those information within few fingertips. Let's say that you want to build an astrolabe, but make it more into like a combination of history and modern arts together, like the 3D printing part or 3D designing element as... Wilfred has done it in ColorDRAW, right?
Mm-hmm.
Using color. So incorporating those software usage or like digital modern design elements with history and the star focus.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
Like a mixture of three elements, and it's inspiring.
Sure.
So once the, let's say, mid-school generation and furthermore, whoever is interested can be part of this thing, they can continue on their own and get their own material and we can provide.
Of course. One thing you can do is, because we have the plastic, for example, this whole star map, this whole beautiful metal part is of course not necessary, because you can put the stars on the plastic and you don't need all these birds and flowers.
Mm-hmm.
But you can, of course, so you can do it, but you can also do without it. And that will make the thing easier to understand, because then you will really see the constellations, so you can recognize Orion in the star map. But the only thing you have to keep in mind that on the astrolabe, the star map is the mirror image of what you see in the sky.
The reason why I'm thinking this from the education perspective is, like what we have been doing in the workshop today, it covers trigonometry, or the basics of usage of trigonometry and the mathematics element, how it comes in a joint part of it. Second, inspiration, like everybody as a human, in a dark place, when they see the stars during the night time, if it's not within the city limits, it's a wow factor. Everyone can be easily mesmerized.
Mm-hmm.
So that, keeping that perspective in mind from the past, and using the stars, the astrolabe, as well as the designing elements, which is something, the tools for the future that they can use in some part of their life, whether it's for just for shopping, their own pictures, for selfies, or something much more modern and forward that they can put into practice in their life.
Yeah. Of course, you can do with it whatever you like. I mean, it's your tradition, so you can continue it the way you love.
So we have that, and we have something that's practical and an element why they're learning. Like, you know, this is a very common question when people, at least in my batch, I have experienced this. When are we going to use this application in life?
Right.
Like mathematics, statistics, probability, like SAS probability, very famous. Yeah, Vegas. But like trigonometry, no one ever says astrolabe, so this could be one of those features.
Did you say a mirror image?
Yeah, Mira Ranch, yeah, I said that.
Because if the if a particular constellation is looking like this,
yeah,
it'll be shown like this on the.
No, because you look at the astrolabe from the outside. You look at the universe from the outside.
Whereas practically you are looking at the sky from inside.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's the mirror image. This is also a question in the workshop, because after plotting these stars, you will discover that the constellations you get are the mirror images of what you see in the sky.
Okay. So if I ask a metal worker in Karachi to make an astrolabe, these are the things that I will tell him.
Yeah.
What is it that he must be very good at? What metal should he use? Should he use brass, or can he use maybe something?
Yeah, I mean, for the material, I think you can use his expertise. He has to engrave something on a plate, but he has to be instructed by someone who is familiar with the astrolabe and its mathematical construction, like the gentleman here who were asking me to provide the formulas that he can that they can use to provide the software. I think if you have the software, it is easy for an astrolabe maker to use that. But my experience is with Professor Sesky, who was the director of a museum in Frankfurt, where he wanted to have copies of many asteroids. And he trained people in Egypt to make them for him, because there were good metal workers. But in the beginning, he always had to return the asteroids, because they never did it right.
Okay.
So you have to expect it will take maybe 5 or 6 trials before.
Yeah, that is the question that I was trying to read.
Yeah. So I think the best thing would be is for yourself to familiarize yourself with it, or have someone close to you who knows exactly how this has to be done. I also think that it helps to sort of draw the thing on paper, maybe not completely, but at least in part, so you are really familiar with what has to be done. Also, there are some choices that you have to make. For example, do you want the astrolabe to be exactly like our model? Our model is very much simplified, because we have no hour lines. Maybe you want hour lines. Which hour lines do you want? These are things you have to to think yourself. I would never copy astrolabe of Avatar, because it's too complicated. It's very nice with all these lines and curves, but you cannot explain it to anyone. So you have to, therefore you need something simpler. But that's up to you. And you can also include other elements, as long as you do not uncritically copy from these European sources.
We never discussed the R lines.
No, well, yeah, it was in the workshop, but there was no time. We discussed the seasonal R lines. I remember we'll get to the drawing. But there are more R lines.
R line, is it the same we use in modern astronomy, or angles? Is it the same?
Well, you can also dispense with the R lines. You can just say, okay, I use only the division into 360 degrees, because that 15 degrees is 1 hour, so the division of hours is already there. So I don't need the hour lines.
But then the sunset and sunrise is according to the modern time then?
No, it's always according to local time. Yeah. Local time is not the same as
standard time,
because we have time zones.
Yeah. Standard time is always different than local time.
Yeah, and also there is equation of time.
Equation
so,
of time.
So, if you teach an astronomy workshop at the same time, you will teach the people about time zones and the equation of time. This is nice, because it's development in the mind. So these are things that exist, and most people don't know them. But they are there.
And astrolabe never corrects for the equation of time?
No. Well, you can, you on the backside, you can make some analemma or whatever, but...
Because the equation of time can be as much as 15 minutes?
I know, but the astrolabe always presents local solar time, that's it.
Local solar time, okay.
Yeah,
so it absorbs the equation of time error into it and everything that...
If you want to have time on your watch, you have to apply the equation of time, and you have to apply a correction for the time zone. There's no other way. But then if you do that, you can use it as a watch, and it's rather accurate, a mistake maybe 5 minutes.
Okay.
No more things that I go over the next thing. So I was going to say something about the differences between Islamic and European astrolabes. Very often on this circular scale, the outside scale of the astrolabe, it's degrees in Islamic astrolabes and hours in European astrolabes. Because the Europeans use hour angles, they didn't use seasonal hours. Because after the 14th century, there were mechanical clocks in most cities. Most cities had towers with clocks. So then the life of the people started to be regulated according to the normal hours that we have. Before that, it was always seasonal hours because the day was 12 hours long. It's much easier to know, okay, now 3/4 of the day has passed, then it's 2 o'clock or it's 4 o'clock.
When did the mechanical clock come into the society as a social...
I think it's in Europe it happened, if I remember correctly, in the 14th or 15th century.
14th, 15th century?
Yeah. So it has it is a European development. It has nothing to do with the Islamic influence. So it happened first in Germany. So in Germany many cities started to build mechanical clocks on their churches. And they could be seen from a large distance. And also the clocks would ring a bell every hour. So in this way, people started to take notice, and then the life changed because seasonal hours were no longer important.
And the astrolabe goes out of fashion primarily because of the mechanical clock.
I think so. Because in the 17th century there were mechanical clocks and watches, so people started to use them. And in our part of the world, there is always a problem because if it's cloudy, you cannot use the astrolabe. There are clouds, here it's often sunny, but in our part it's often cloudy, then it's useless. Because you have to measure some celestial body in order to use it. If your sky is cloudy 2/3 of the time, as it is in our country, then already it's less important.
So when you're looking at a watch, you're actually looking at a modern astrolabe?
I wouldn't say that, because the watch doesn't involve any observation of a celestial body. It just involves some atoms which are pulsating.
But the very reason that it runs like this clockwise is because it is an evolution from the astrolabe.
Yeah, I think it has to do with the apparent rotation of the universe. Yes.
If it was made in the southern hemisphere, the clock would be running like this.
Maybe.
No?
Maybe. Yeah, I'm not sure about things. These things really have to investigate to see what happens. And of course, what you say now, if it had developed in the southern hemisphere, we don't know. Because it didn't happen. So if something didn't happen, you can say, if this had happened, then that. Then this is something that is, let's say, epistemologically different. It's difficult to say. You want to correct, to comment on that.
I agree with you.
Let's see what else. There are some very important practical things. So let me explain to you now our secrets and how we prepare. Always prepare everything yourself. So now I'm saying very strange things. Always prepare everything yourself. Do not expect them to have prepared anything. Do everything in time. So if you want to have photocopies, you'll make the photocopies yourself. Because if you go to some place in Iran, for example, where we are often going, and you ask them to do a photocopy, then, for example, in one place, the photocopy machine could only be operated by someone who was ill. So no photocopies. This is why you have to be prepared for
the machine was
ill. Yeah, well. And then I think preparing your astrolabe drawing, your astrolabe model, is very time consuming. I spent a lot of time on that, and Wilfred, you also spent a lot of time.
Yeah, because it's like hands work. You have to make a hole in every sheet of paper and in every piece of plastic. They're connected. It just adds up.
How long does it take to actually draw it in Corel or something?
Oh, just some hours, I think.
Some hours.
Yeah.
But then probably there were some mistakes.
No, then you can. You have to order the paper and the sheets because you cannot buy them anymore in shops. The transparency sheets, because no one is using overhead projectors anymore. So you have to order them in Amazon.com.
And then you print it on the...
Yeah, and you should know how to operate a copying machine in order to copy on plastic or print on plastic.
And the cutting as well.
And the cutting, you should do the heads, of course, one by one.
For every participant, that's a lot of work. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So Wilfred did all of that.
Wonderful.
And then some copy machines have strange way of copying. If you copy a circle, it will produce an ellipse. So this is something that you
yes.
have to say.
And there's also one other thing. It's also important to use the same machine for printing the paper part as the plastic part,
uh-huh.
because there might be different dimensions for whatever reason, and then the spider will not fit anymore onto the plate.
Yeah.
And the astrolabes will become useless. That happened to me before at the beginning.
You don't have to throw it away. I mean, this happened many times to me also. If you have the spider which is half a centimeter less than what it should be. Or on one side it's okay, but on the other side it's not. It's not, because the printer prints it as an ellipse. Although I program it as a circle. So. Yeah, and also the difficulty of getting push buttons and sheets, because you need push buttons. And some models work and other models don't. And for example, once we had a push button which was too little, so it exploded. So half of the workshop, they all came off. You don't want to do that. So
yeah.
Therefore,
that also had to do with previously we were making the holes in the plastic and the paper by using a compass and then doing some cutting with a scissor. But now I'm making holes using.
Yeah. You have to show us their secret tool.
This is very important.
This is very good, because now the two parts are very well fixed together.
I have not seen it so far.
Yeah, he was showing me earlier, so there was a secret tool.
Ah, it's you. Okay. So this you can, so it has a hole of 2 millimeters. And you can make the holes in the plastic and the paper using a hammer. You can do it exactly in the middle. That's also very important.
Yeah.
And then you can you should buy push buttons which have the same size as the hole. Then it fits very well together.
So basically exactly how they did it in the old days.
Yeah, maybe.
Hammer, then.
मैंने बताया था कि ये जो प्लास्टिक शीट है ये इजीली प्रेस वालों से अवेलेबल होती है उनको आप बताएंगे तो एग्जैक्टली वो सेम वो निकाल देंगे प्रिंट
वो हमारे यहाँ मिलते हैं ना वहाँ तो
नहीं यानी वो जब चाहिए हो तो हमारे यहाँ हमें सिर्फ अब सिर्फ वो सॉफ्ट कॉपी मिल जाए तो हम इसको यूं बना देंगे
तुम सिर्फ एक प्रिंटर होना चाहिए
दोनों सेम चाहिए वो सेम मिलेगा यानी जो सेम साइज देंगे वो सेम प्रिंट आउट plastic printer. Yeah.
But there is another important aspect which Tom suggested, and we had a lot of discussion about it in the last day. This is you have to, there is one thing we have not treated in these workshops, that is the mathematical background, stereographic projection,
yes,
and
yes.
Why exactly these things are as they are. And we have not treated that in the workshop because we can communicate it, but the best way to communicate it is after you have heard all these things. So we could, of course, we could have a lecture by me and I could explain this to you. But the reason why I want to bring this up here is that you have to understand these things, even though even if you do not teach them at all. So if you teach an astrolabe workshop, you have to understand the mathematical background, and you have to be able to derive these projections and these formulas yourself. I think this is also an important point. Because you may be challenged. There may be people in the audience who know a lot about these things. And they may be really interested, and they may ask questions about it. And then you will have to answer. So you have to study it. Morrison's book is very good because it has material stereographic projections. So you don't need my lecture. You can read it there. And that is also on the internet in various places. But that's important, so don't teach a workshop before having looked at all this material. Now some more things.
What is the better logic to, as far as the sequence of conducting a workshop? Should you first give them, like you did, Wilfred giving us those things and you do the initial part, and then you come to the mathematics part, which is your lecture today. Or should you do this first and then distribute that?
Well, I have not done the mathematics at all. Because mathematics shows why do we have to draw the compact circles in this way, and why do we have to draw the asymptotic circles in this way, why do we have to draw the ecliptic in this way. I could explain this. But then that requires sort of an ability of the audience to absorb that kind of thing. And I always think in my philosophy that this is not a very effective way to communicate. So I think for that you would need, I guess, an additional one or two days, which consist of lectures with many exercises, because then the audience will do exercises. So this I could prepare, of course. You can also find the information in the literature. But if you want, I will be glad to prepare that some other time for you. But that, I think, in my opinion, it makes sense only once you have an astrolabe already. But this is my experience, my concept. Because people need motivation. And motivation comes from seeing the thing.
Yes.
So you know there is something called the Lahore astrolabe, but first I am teaching you mathematics for 20 days, and you have to bear with me, and then you will see how nice it is. This is the traditional approach. I don't like it.
Because I did an astrolabe workshop, and we started with the mathematics part actually. And I could see boys were sort of not very interested in the second or the third lecture.
Yeah, yeah. So well, but maybe these things work for us, but the best way. But maybe for you they work differently. So you choose these things. We are not saying them in order to say to you, you should do it this way, but only in order to share our experiences. And then you can do with these experiences what you want. So we make our experience available to you, and then you decide what you do. Because some of what we say may not be relevant for you at all. Let's see. I think one thing which we find very effective is, remember in the first workshop there were four, we handed out forms, and people had to write on them. What is your birthday? Write from them. Then what sign of the ecliptic? Write. What degree? Write. And then what is the position of the pointer? Write. Because before we did that, people asked, it said, well, we have such a problem, we don't understand. And then the difficulty was never clear. But if you see on the form, you can see, okay, they have filled out the first three questions correctly.
Yes.
And now the question is about the fourth question.
Mm-hmm. So that's doing in parts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but then force them to write something.
Yeah, exactly.
Because many people are not able to express themselves clearly.
Exactly.
So yes. This saves a lot. When did we start with these forms?
Was it
already 10 years?
Before your time, right?
Yeah.
So 10 years already.
Mm-hmm. What did you do 10 years before?
Oh, we did it before, without forms. We have done it with forms the last 10 years. It seems very childish in somehow, as if you are at school, fill out the forms, not something that they want.
Yeah.
And some people don't want it.
But when you didn't do it with forms, they were not interested. This is what you're saying, huh?
Also you can... There are, in Iran is especially very funny because there are some people who find themselves very important and who behave as if they understand everything. And then when you say, okay, fill out this form, then they have great difficulty of filling out the first form. And there are some young people, very, very nice ladies who are very modestly dressed and so on, who fill out these forms and you see they can understand things immediately. This is very good as a means for you to find how they are doing. So we find it very effective. Next thing, this workshop can be given to many audiences. And we have given it to... To audiences, for example, the Sufi audience. And so what we did, we used some poetry of Maulana Jalaluddin Rumi about the astrolabe. We do have things like that. We can email them to you. There's a specialty fee, I have it here with respect to email in Persian with the English translation.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So that's
that creates an added interest.
Yeah.
Yeah, because then you can give it to people, you can say, okay, this is a workshop about art, and especially it will help you to understand some poetry. For example,
So Professor was actually telling me some verses from Rumi.
Yeah, well,
so if you could talk about the verses again.
Yeah, I can. There's one verse in
Masnavi. So these are very important verses.
One verse in Masnavi which says, "Ilat aashik ze ilat har judas, ish usturaba asrar khadas." This means the disease of the lover, mystical lover, is different from other diseases. Love is the astrolabe of the secrets of God.
Beautiful.
There is another passage from Fihi Ma Fihi, which is somewhat more extensive, but I will read it. I have the translation by Arbery. I have my own translation, which I have changed a little bit, but this I don't have here. A human being is the astrolabe of God, but it requires an astronomer to use the astrolabe. If a vegetable seller or a greengrocer should find an astrolabe, what good would it do them from that astrolabe? What could they know about the movements of the circling stars, the positions of the planets, their influences, and so forth? But in the hands of the astronomer, the astrolabe becomes truly valuable. Just as this copper astrolabe reflects the movements of the heaven like a mirror, so the human being is the astrolabe of God. And then there is a quotation from Quran: "We have honored the children of Adam." And then Rumi continues: "Those who have been moved by God to see the one reality and learn its ways through the astrolabe of their own being, through the astrolabe of their own being, behold, movement by movement, flesh by flesh, the testament of God. Indeed, it is an infinite beauty that never leaves their mirror." So this is difficult to understand, but if you have an astrolabe, then you know what this means. So you, in this way, you can make it attractive to, you can have here your literary session.
Yes.
So many people are very interested. Practice, if possible, for a critical audience before you teach the workshop, of course. And the setting is very, very important.
Yes.
As you did here, it was perfect. With these tables, the assistants have to be able to go around, and also the people have to cooperate with each other. Because in an astrolabe workshop, you will have people with very different knowledge. Some people with a lot of knowledge, and some people with very little knowledge. And you want to make the workshop a rewarding experience for all. And the solution to that problem is by putting all of them on one table. Because then, some people can be helped by others. We have also seen it in this group.
So, a group, a table should have all kind of experience.
Usually that's solved by itself.
And those who are not very knowledgeable, they are helped by the others.
Normally it happens. And you are not going to say, okay, I can see that you are not very knowledgeable, so please sit here. Thank you. Now, of course, there should be enough assistance. I mean, this is a big thing, because we are three, and this is very important. Three is very different from two. I mean, if you have, for example, Tom and I, or Wilfred and I would teach this together, it would be much more strain and much more work for us. But three really is, or at least three is the ideal.
Three is a good figure.
Yeah. Never less than three, I would say. So this is also my experience, because if you are two, then you have to go everywhere, and it's frustrating because people are asking questions everywhere. They have to wait for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, they get frustrated, it's not going to work. So that, there are of course in the audience also people who ask a lot of attention and do not understand much. So they ask the same question 10 times. And this you can also solve by putting all these people together on the table, because then the other people will help them and it sort of will be resolved. I think. There may also be psychological reasons why someone wants to draw your attention constantly and ask the same question 10 times. And that you don't have that if you have this ideal setting. I think these were my suggestions.
I think these are very valuable.
Do you have anything to add?
Well, be patient as a teacher. It's not these subjects can be hard to grasp. Be patient. Let people give people some time to digest it. You cannot force learning.
So I have a question. If one of my students, if they want to ask me that. Well, they've understood the whole phenomenon on paper, now they want to make an astrolabe, and they don't want to get into the business of forging metals or maybe, drawing on metals. So what's the most suitable material? I was thinking of wood. What would you recommend?
First, I would try to make it on paper. Always do that first. And then after that, you can use wood. I mean, the Turkish people are doing that. I have a wooden model with me here. I would say metal is very complicated. I mean, there are some people who can do it.
Cardboard, plastics.
Maybe cardboard and plastic. There is, on the internet, there are also people who have various programs for that. There's one man who has, I think, everything to make an astrolabe out of plastic. It's on the internet. But it's a European astrolabe, always. So then you have to change his methodology. But maybe 3D printing can be used.
There are no kits for sale available in the market?
There used to be cardboards in was sold somewhere in America, I believe Chicago, but I don't think it's on the market anymore. And I have tried to convince Islamic societies to publish a cardboard kit like that, because I think there would be a lot of appeal for it.
Yes.
Then modeled on an Islamic aspect. So this is something that could be done and should be done. I can't do it. But some Islamic, I have tried to convince the Institute for History of Arabic Islamic Science in Frankfurt to do that. They have never done it. Because they the director was sort of like this. He didn't want to spend his time. So, but this would be a nice project for you here, maybe, if you can do it. You can put it online, you can sell it. Yeah, for you?
Yeah.
If you want to. So the Lahore Astrolabe, and again we will have Lahore Astrolabe
and challenges.
Our religious teachers, they are actually planning to include this in their regular program of madrasas.
Very excellent.
To learn how to use it and to actually make an astrolabe.
And then they also have to include some. An Asr prayer line, a line for Asr prayer, which we have not discussed. But it is
that can be done.
Yeah, it can be done. Very nice.
Amazing.
I think it was part of one of the exercises as well.
The prayer time?
Yeah.
Only Fajr. But for Asr, it can also be done.
So only two prayer times. Yeah.
I think
because
if we add a prayer line for Asr, there are lines for everything. So once you rotate a dial, you actually have the all the prayer chart of India. Yeah.
And then there is this quadrant. Quadrant is an outcome of astrolabe, is it? And then I heard navigation on the sea can be done through some extension of astrolabe. Some extension of astrolabe.
A very simple form of the astrolabe, which you get by deleting the plate. And you delete the plate and you delete the star map. So I don't know in what sense you would call this an astrolabe.
Yes.
And what's a quadrant?
A quadrant is that's something else. It's a sort of a trigonometric thing. It has nothing to do with astrolabe. There are some astrolabe quadrants, but we have a workshop on quadrants, but we don't have it here, do we? No, it's some workshop which we did in this town is really done by a computer. You can make trigonometrical calculations very easily, at least some trigonometrical calculations. But it is another subject. We have a workshop which you can send to if you like.
Yeah, sure.
We would love to have you there again. No?
You just invite us. I mean, if you arrange, I think there may probably get the visa, but we will contact the Pakistani embassy in the Netherlands after returning,
yes.
And then offer them to give to them a lecture on the astrolabe. Because the guy who accepted our application, of course, we were in the Iran mood, so we thought it would be extremely difficult to get a visa. So we thought, well, I don't know, who will get it. So we prepared ourselves very well in all the forms, and then I had copied the whole astrolabe for Allah Dan, his signature, from Lahori. And so we submitted all this material with the Lahori on top, and it so happened that the man who received this knew something about that. So he thought, oh, how nice a model, and can you put the sun on the my birthday on Sunday? Was asked.
Oh, we knew it.
Maybe I can come to your workshop, and he said, okay, workshop here. Okay,
just
so
give
okay,
us the visa
here,
first.
Here is the application. He said, okay, you wait. And so we waited, and after 1 hour, we were still sitting there. And even Tom said, shall we leave or shall we do what happens? And then I said, okay, you can pay now. Okay. This is usually a very good sign if you're an embassy and they say you can pay. So I thought, wow, maybe we'll get the visa in 3 weeks. So I paid, and then there were the passports with the visa.
Oh, wow.
So then we went to have some cookies and coffee somewhere.
They're wonderful.
That's how Pakistan is.
Not Iran.
We are very friendly people.
Yeah, but we want to do something for these people. To thank them, but it's better to do it after, because then we can have our experience.
We are very friendly people. We Pakistanis.
Yeah, now we know by experience.
Yeah.
बुक्स का उन्होंने कह दिया कि वो देंगे
बस वही आपके जरूर
कुछ विलफर्ड he'll be giving some handouts or books or
yeah, yeah. Thank you so much materials.
Is that it?
Yeah. So in about you came late. It was a very long workshop. It's not like only this
it's
part.
It's not so. Like my day wasn't busy.
So in 5 minutes we'll be leaving.
John, the Karachi guys.
Who?
The Karachi, Karachi.
People.
People,
yeah.
They are all they're watching us, and they're waiting.
I think you're just scared.
Because they keep asking me every day, how is it going?
Oh, I'm not scared. Although they have told us that, they have told us many bad things. Of course, Karachi is a criminal city, and you can only go there. Some people with you who have. Automatic rifles to protect you.
No.
It's probably not true. But we have the same experience in Iran, and people also told us horrible things about it. And then we went to it, and it was very nice. So.